Welcome to Politics
of Code, our lecture series on politics and interactive media. So the question, if code is political, I mean, these days seems kind of trivial. Everyone knows that because so much is even in mainstream media now on the political implication of software. Software is eating the world, as Marc Andreessen, the programmer of the first web browser, the Netscape Navigator, once said, founding his venture capital firm, Andreessen Horowitz. So software is eating the world, and so better know what political implications are behind software. And I mean, speaking of the web browser, that is about the time, 25 years or so, that we can look back, that people actually use the term politics of code to describe what we want to explore during this class. So the first instance, as far as I could research, of using the term politics of code is actually from 1995. That is only 2 years after the World Wide Web started, after the first web browser was conceived. So that is really a time when the internet became for the first time something that could make digital network technology tangible for people outside the military or computer science departments.
So,
William J. Mitchell, an architect and urban designer, wrote in 1995 already this book, City of Bits. It's a super interesting book, and Mitchell is really one of the really forward-looking thinkers of the 1990s. He died in 2010, a professor at MIT for architecture. And what he sees here is that cities will become programmed. So there will be software running our urban environments. And the citizens of the cities will not be able to understand what's going on unless they really learn to code.
And another thing,
about the same time, Douglas Rushkoff, who is also one of these early digital thinkers, he wrote for Mondo 2000, and then he was teaching at ITP, NYU, New York. He's now a professor at the City University of New York and has published a lot of books, very critical books about digital technology. But at the time, in 1995 or so, he was quite euphoric still that the digital technology would be empowering people. And he coined the famous phrase, program or be programmed. So this is the idea that we have here in interactive media, that we think of code as a metaphor of everything technological that has digital components in it and can be programmed. And then we ask ourselves, how do we look behind the scenes?
What
does it mean to be political?
The word political
is an old word. I mean, it's Greek, has been used since ancient times, particularly made a term by Aristotle in his book
Politics.
Aristotle is the first to understand that there is two parts of human life that are very distinct in the function for us.
The
one part is our survival. This is what we share with the animals. So we have to eat, we have to keep our family warm, we take care of those we love, we need shelter, and so on. So this is not particularly human, but it is part of the human condition.
Survival.
Bottle is nothing political. So to survive, everything is legitimate.
You can't
deny a human being the fight for their own denial, for their own survival.
And so,
of survival, of caring for your food, for your shelter, for your health,
is not political.
It is a necessary condition to live. And since the Greek word for the stove or the oven is oikos, this is where you prepare the food,
Aristotle
called this sphere of life oikonomi.
So oikonomi
is the part of life that is not governed by ethics, but is economical. And in opposition to this is the polis. The polis is the city, is where people agree to live a life together that is governed by rules. And these rules are above survival. These rules are, for example, that even if you are hungry, you just don't go to your neighbor and kill them and take their food. It is society's duty to redistribute food without violence. That is a typical political decision. And Aristotle says, to do politics, you have to be free of economics. So the economic sphere is, so to say,
the foundation,
and politics is the superstructure. That is the terms that Marx would use for this dialectic relationship. Hannah Arendt, in the mid-20th century, analyzing the complete disaster that led to the Second World War, to fascism in Europe in particular, of course, to National Socialism in Germany and the Holocaust, this human condition in this Aristotelian sense, and reassessed what it means to be political. And that's what she writes here in her book, The Human Condition, that action is the conditio per quam. So taking action is by definition already political. So this is an interesting idea, that being active, leading an active life in society, is the political act.
And here in the
third paragraph is where she then describes this Aristotelian distinction, so that there is the oikos, but we need politics to govern what's going on in the oikos. So without politics, without this free discussion of what's right or wrong,
economy
will just take over. And you will see over the whole course of these lectures now, that it is exactly this negotiation that we have to be very critical of, that is going on and has been going on for a long time. There's economic forces, shareholder value, people having businesses to run. And of course, they want their businesses to flourish.
And
society has interests to have a stable political system, maybe representation, a government that is not just be overthrown. And to achieve that, regulation has to take place, rules are set up. And depending on where you sit yourself, seeing yourself in, like, it is society entirely defining these rules, or society has also the obligation to accept a certain economic interest, or even to say society has actually no say at all in that, because economy, in this libertarian sense, is just
self-creating
order, defines your ideological stand.
So in all
this, make it clear that technology, which is defining for our societies, for our, in particular, civilization today, is inherently political.
So let's discuss
that a bit and look a bit closer. So if we think of code, code is something logical. It is a set of rules that is executed by a computer, line by line. And if you look at this example here, that is a very famous algorithm. The algorithm is about 2,500 years old. It was first published, probably known earlier, but first published by the Greek mathematician and physicist Eratosthenes. So Eratosthenes was an interesting guy. He was also the first to fully understand what it means that the Earth is a ball and would quite successfully measure the Earth's circumference using shadows that fall on sticks. He was really good at that. It's only a few percent of 300 before the Common Era, he would publish that measuring the distance between his home, Alexandria in Egypt, and the city of Cyrene, which is at the tropics. And Eratosthenes also came up with this very handy algorithm to calculate prime numbers. So this is the sieve of Eratosthenes. And I mean, it's totally clear that how you do that. I mean, you basically just take all the multiples of the numbers and then you look in the end which numbers are left. And it's a very efficient way of calculating. It's the efficient way of calculating prime numbers. And it is the only way, I think, to calculate all prime numbers. So this is the sieve of Eratosthenes. And clearly, there is no ambiguity. This is not a political algorithm. If you look at this, so this is Professor Heather and myself in Milan at an art exhibition by the artist Trevor Peglin, together with the political activist and researcher Kate Crawford. And they explored common image recognition technology here. And this is an algorithm also. I mean, there's software behind it, machine learning software. We'll look into that at the later part of this lecture series. And if you look at this classification as who we are seeing here, so, I mean, I am a security consultant and Professor Heather is a sleeper or a slumberer. And you don't need to have a lot of political sensitivity to realize that this is quite a problematic way of seeing people. I mean, me, the man, of course, being something like a consultant and in particular an engineering consultant, and the woman, of course, is just slumbering away. And it's totally clear that this algorithm is a totally different animal than the sieve of Eratosthenes. So while the sieve of Eratosthenes is undeniably mathematically unambiguous, there is just no other way of calculating prime numbers as just coming out with them. You can use whatever method you want and you will end up at the same prime numbers. This is, of course, not true with classifying people like us here in this funny photo. So why are these algorithms so different? I mean, there's software behind both of them. But the second one contains something that is called a value judgment. So value judgments, that's a concept by the German philosopher Immanuel Kant. For example, other people have written about that also. So Kant sees this as the key feature of our reason. This is how we have critical understanding of the world. This is by judgment. We take something and decide that it is the one thing and not the other. And Kant is very clear on that there is no logical necessity on judgment. This makes it a judgment. It is our judgment. It is subjective. That doesn't mean it is arbitrary and random. I mean, of course, we can, for example, see something that looks like an apple and say that's a pear. I mean, we are free to do that, but that is nonsensical. I mean, of course, we would probably say that's an apple, but you could also say it's a fruit. It's a fruit of the rose plants or whatever category would might to choose.
And the judgment
doesn't mean that it is random, but it is nevertheless a decision that we make. And we bake that into software. I mean, just to give you a preview, we will look a bit into advertising later. And this is, for example, Google's advertising classification of me. So you see, as what I am classified with Google, I mean, clearly they see my gender and age correctly. And then they come up with all these interesting things in which I might be interested, like Brazilian music. I have zero idea how that came up. I can't remember ever having Googled anything about Brazilian music, but probably I have without even remembering that. And since that is a very unique feature, Google extracts that and I get that pinned on my lapel like a badge. So these are value judgment that software gets baked into, and the political implication of that is exactly in the way Mitchell saw already in 1995 that if we don't understand how software, how technology works, we have no chance of seeing what's going on here, because if you are not already quite savvy in technology, you will just not find where Google shows you these advertising preferences.
So
savviness is one of the conditions that you have to have to be politically active in a digital time. But it is unfortunately not sufficient, because even in seeing that Google targets me like that, I have very little agency to tell Google that I actually don't want to be targeted. It is a thing that I am powerless against. I'm just passive in that. I mean, I can tick these boxes and say, well, actually, I don't want Brazilian music as a property of mine here, but I can't really influence how Google sees me. And of course, I have no idea what's going on behind the scenes at all.
So
Sarah Watson, who has been a very interesting theorist and advocate of justice and agency in the political field, many years ago gave this talk. So this is long before the Trump presidency. And here she gives this list of criteria by which products find their targets on Facebook.
And if you look
at that, it is really striking how easy it is to find vulnerable populations here. So like people who are in financial trouble, but also people who are racists. Facebook delivers that to you and you can buy ads to advertise specifically to these people. By that, your ads get much cheaper than they would be if you would just buy ad space at large. And the second thing also happens, I, who's not in one of these categories, might never see what Facebook displays to these people. So these people get things advertised for, or people exclude them from ads as well, that I can't see. And I mean, the whole years that have passed with the rise of violent neo-fascism on social media, most people have actually hardly seen any of that, except when you are really looking for it. So for many people in my among my friends or my colleagues or so, they only know about these horrible ads on social media, about these horrible campaigns and conversations by hearsay, because it's not trivial to find them.
A whole
different take on political technology is the design. So this is Apple's face recognition algorithm that unlocks the iPhone. So if you look in the phone should automatically unlock. Unfortunately, it only does that very well if you are a, I would say, middle-aged Caucasian male. If you are from other ethnicities, it becomes significantly less likely that the phone recognizes you correctly. It takes more effort or it becomes more blurry. A lot has been written about that. And in particular, the algorithm completely fails if something happens that could not be foreseen. So I tried, for example, to train the algorithm to recognize me while wearing a face mask. And of course it fails because it was not built to do that.
That is not a
natural law. There is no necessity that the algorithm would not know me despite wearing a mask.
It is built that way. Not a design
change, decision. So that's the RTA app in Dubai, by which you can pay your parking fees and look up your trains. And when you use the app once in a while, you express your happiness. I mean, that is very blatantly political, of course, because, I mean, it kind of suggests to you to be happy. I mean, you see this smile face. And so, I mean, actually, I mean, how cruel would you be to say, no, I'm not happy here. So what you are experience here is what in technological terms is called nudging. So this design nudges you to feel better.
Interesting.
Question is also about the industry as such. So the technology industry clearly has become a major spectacle. So about 10 years ago or so, I took this photo here, visiting a colleague at Facebook. Facebook at that time in their still old headquarters, and you see these huge groups, so a huge group of, I don't know, like 30 or so Chinese tourists. So a continuous flow of tourists would be led through Facebook's headquarters. So Facebook as a company is like Disney or like
the Empire State
Building or so, a tourist site. So this is not to be underestimated. I mean, it is, says something about Facebook's brand value. So clearly these tech companies have achieved here something that is not trivial in economy. They have become a spectacle of their own. Technology as political is a rather recent development. The so-called turn to technology
is
maybe like in the late 1980s or so with the conception of science and technology studies. So in the readings, you have Winner, the politics of artifacts, and Vulgar, his reply on that. And I can only suggest recommend that you thoroughly read that, because these are the two crucial texts that in a way define the field. I mean, why did this turn to technology take place after the Second World War? I mean, following Vulgar here, I mean, what has taken place is that technology suddenly becomes
all dominating.
I mean, literally to the level of the existence of humankind. And that is nuclear power and the atomic bomb. So with nuclear weapons and nuclear power, technology enters a level of power that you can't just let it to stay with the engineers. This led to this turn to technology over the course of the 1950s and 60s. More and more thinking went into that. One of the very influential texts is A Question Concerning Technology by Heidegger. And after that, more and more philosophers ask this question about technology. What does it actually mean to have technology, for example, as a commodity, technology as a weapon, technology as a means of production, like the Marxist critique of technology that it is capital intensive and by that replaces labor, and so on. This pervasiveness and existential threat of technology over the last years has reached, I would say, a new level with the discussion around artificial intelligence. I mean, here you see one of the prototypes of Google's self-driving car. It's in a museum. It is actually in the Deutsche Museum in Munich, my hometown. You see this kind of timid, cute little car designed not to pose any threat. On top of the car roof, you see the LiDAR and the other sensors hidden in this black dome. I mean, clearly this car demonstrates and presents to the outside, I am of no harm to you. And I think that is generally true. I mean, already assistive technologies make driving cars much safer, even if you are not in full self-driving car capabilities, which actually might take a while until it is actually feasible. Already, like collision prevention and keeping your distance from the next car, cruise control and things like that. I mean, make driving much, much safer. So
probably that's
actually not what people are afraid of. And Google is trying to distract us here from what is really going on. Because what is actually going on here is driving vehicles is one of the most common professions in the world. So in many, many countries in the world, driving trucks and other commercial vehicles is the most common profession, at least among men. And if you look around the UAE, for example, all the trucks that drive up and down, all the services that do deliveries and logistics, I mean,
transportation
is a huge sector of employment.
I mean, the promise
of the self-driving car, of course, is to replace. That is a very political promise. And this, of course, that
calls for
a lot of concern.
Another political
discussion. It's very funny here. This is also many, many years ago. I think it was 2014 or so at South by Southwest conference, this panel on voter technology. So this is years before we had the discussion, the recent discussions here. But it is after the probably fraudulent vote in favor of George Bush to become president. So voter technology as a way, on the one hand, to for voter enfranchisement. So the question is always, how do you get people to the ballots? How do you include people in a democracy that everyone can cast their votes? I mean, in Europe, for example, election day in all countries is always on a holiday. In most countries on the continent, it is on a Sunday and everyone gets off. In the UK, the election day, I think it's usually on a Thursday, but it's a public holiday. So people have time to go to the ballot in person. Another way to voter repression than just making it on a normal workday and don't give people off is by making it very hard to register for your vote. And that is the way many states in the US prevent people of color from being legally registered. And a lot of thought has been put forward to use technology to mitigate that. However, maybe that's not the right approach. Maybe it is not so technological after all, but more a question of procedure. This question alone, is it technology that can help, or should we just rethink how we organize elections, is very political. I took also in my hometown, Munich, shows you two interesting pieces of technology, of surveillance technology, actually. It's cameras. So the one camera, this long thing that looks like a typical camera, like cameras have been looking for, I don't know, 40, 50 years.
This camera
points towards the train. It will display a picture of the train's doors to the engineer who drives the train. It is not surveillance. Everyone can see where the camera points. But next to it is a different device. It is this black glass dome. This makes it impossible to see in which direction the camera is pointed. This, of course, is a very political expression of surveillance. This camera prevents you from seeing if you are on camera, but it makes you aware that you will be surveyed occasionally. Old technology I found here in the beautiful city of Lewes, south of London. Lewes is very well known for a very sturdy Norman castle, about 1,000 years old. And here you see a small manor in the middle of the city with beautiful benches where you can enjoy the traditional English gardening art. So it's very inviting. At another site here in Lewes, in another garden, you see another design for a bench. So this bench has a weird,
board in the middle
of it. Why is that? Well, that's a piece of design that's called anti-social design. It's has become, I think, a proper urban term, urban design term, to make things anti-social. So that means that if you are tired, you cannot lie down on this bench. Often benches or chairs in public places are designed that they become quite uncomfortable after 5 or 10 minutes sitting on them to prevent people from staying there too long. Another kind of tricks that are done with technology, so to say, with design to make to nudge people into the desired behavior. So this antisocial, so this intentionally nudging people to antisocial behavior is, I think, an important aspect of technology design to keep in mind.
We
have already discussed, and if you read Winner's text, so Winner has these two main arguments. So the one is the bridges in Long Island, New York, where the totally horrible racist urban planner Robert Moses intentionally built the bridges so low that public transport buses could not go there. And by that preventing people who would not own their own car from going to the beaches, basically. While that is debated in the other article that you will read, another example that Winner gives is that of the harvester, of the tomato harvester in California that was deployed in agriculture despite being actually of poorer quality and higher costs of production than the manual laborers who just had formed, unfortunately, a union and by that became inconvenient for the landowners. So, looking into technology around you, you might find similar examples. So, for example, here, this is the front car of the Dockland Light Railway in London. So the Docklands used to be where the ships were built and the harbor was in 150 years or so ago in London. So if you read like Sherlock Holmes stories or so, this is where all the crime happens or so. This is kind of the dark part of London. After the ships became bigger and bigger and the harbor moved further out, closer to the coast, to coastal towns like Southampton, and the London Docklands fell into despair. That happened in many, many cities. If you look in Abu Dhabi, for example, the Mina of Abu Dhabi is no longer really a port. It's also abandoned and gets reconstructed. So this is as such nothing special. It is just a part of urban change. An industry moves out and regions change. And in the late 1970s and early 80s, the city of London had to decide what to do with the Docklands. It is also the time when Margaret Thatcher became prime minister in Great Britain. And Margaret Thatcher is well known as being kind of this very hardline libertarian conservative. So libertarian and not at all conservative in her economic politics, which meant a radical move towards privatization. So what in previous times would be publicly owned by the state, was sold away, was privatized. And the whole Docklands became sold to financial companies and housing, basically. That as such is, I think, not so much debatable. I mean, what else would you do with this vast land? Interesting is the public transport system that was built here. Thatcher's kind of most infamous political move was in fighting against the unions. And the unions in England were very strong. One industry was basically always on strike. So that is just how it is in Europe. It's the same where I come from in Germany. There's always, like the railroad workers, they strike every other year. And then for several days, sometimes for several weeks, no trains run. And I mean, that is, of course, inconvenient, but I mean, is it really so bad? I don't know. I mean, who cares, actually? I mean, the world doesn't end if trains don't run. Or maybe they do. I don't know. So Thatcher was particularly annoyed by that and wanted to break the power of the unions. And she did that by investing in a totally new experimental technology, which is self-driving trains. And the London Dockland Light Railway, DLR, is one of the very first real metropolitan train systems that is self-driving. At that time, that was by no ways any cheaper than hiring a driver to drive these cars. So there is no real economic reason to do that other than getting rid of the drivers. However, if you use the DLR regularly, you will soon see that actually it is not that self-driving after all, that more often than not, an engineer comes aboard and starts operating the train manually. Because something doesn't work, the trains are not that perfect anyway, and so there is a lot of manual labor still required. However, the role of the driver, of the engineer, has changed.
From being indispensable, from
being an important part of the system, to being expendable and just precarious. The fight against the machines is a very long one. I mean, it is at least 250 years, if not longer, in Europe. The first, I would say, broad instance of this fight against the machines is known as sabotage or ludism. So sabot is these wooden shoes that French workers or French peasants would wear. When the production of textiles changed in the mid of the 18th century from people producing textiles at home on the weavers' looms that they owned to mass producing textiles in factories, they protest their disenfranchisement, their exploitation, by occasionally dropping one of their shoes into the machines and by that destroying them. I mean, a bit more violent is Ned Ludd. Ned Ludd is this British labor leader who is well known for smashing the machine. So that is, of course, then the iconoclasm that is often part of this rage against the machines. So no question that for the weavers, technology is very political.
So the science
and technology studies, I mean, it's not only technology that is political, and it's important to keep in mind that it is the sciences as well. So one of the founding fathers of that field, Ludwig Fleck, who was born in Lemberg, now Lvov in Ukraine, at the time when he was born, it was part of Austria-Hungary. It's, by the way, where part of my father's family is also from. So it's very far in the east, and it's very interesting that that Fleck had such an influence with his writings on Entstehung und Entwicklung einer wissenschaftlichen Tatsache. So the genesis and development of scientific fact. And what Fleck came up with is that there is what he calls Denkstil, the style of thought, or das Denkkollektiv. So the collective of thought, he says, so first of all, we have our own preferences, our taste, our style, and that is how we think. And then second of all, we live in a collective with other people, and that defines what we actually believe is true. And he says that wherever you look, so he was a biologist and he was working in microbiology in the 1920s and 30s. So wherever you look, you see that scientists make these decisions according to their style of thoughts or to the pressure of their collective of thoughts.
So the
technology as being even a means of politics starts very explicitly in the beginnings of digital technology in the late 19th century. So in the 1880s, German immigrant to the United States, Hermann Hollerith, who was an employee in the US Census Bureau, so he was in charge of archiving the census and organizing part of the census. So in the census, and basically every citizen is asked certain questions. I mean, to get a good statistical overview of the population, it's done every 10 years. And at the time when Hollerith worked at the Census Bureau, getting the data together of the census that was taken took almost 10 years to do. So it was just before the next census would start that you would actually have the results of the last census together. And Hollerith was very dissatisfied of that and thought that they must go somehow faster. And he came up with an ingenious invention, that is the punch card. So with the punch card, you punch holes into a paper card. I mean, depending on the answers that the surveyed people give on their questionnaires, and then you run the punch cards through a machine that has little metal brushes, and whenever there's a hole in the punch card, a circuit is closed, right? And a counter gets a small electrical impulse and pushes the hand of these clocks one point further. So instead of having people making long lists of the answers on the surveys and then adding these lists up manually, You have then now a totally new profession of the punch card operator, which was mainly women. It was people who were very fast and very skilled in translating the survey questionnaires into punch cards. And then, of course, immediately people saw that that could be used for any kind of data, and that was a whole revolution. And the company that Hollerith founded was the International Business Machines, IBM.
Immediately
after the punch card system of Hollerith was invented, it became clear that it would serve also a very political other cause, that is of classifying people according to their race. And I mean, the fascists in Europe, in particular the Nazis in Germany, were very progressive in their use of technology. And it is really horrible how IBM made themselves complicit with the Nazis in organizing the Holocaust. It's totally clear that without the database technology of IBM, the Nazis would never have been able so quickly sort out all the Jews in all the countries that Germany occupied, in particular, of course, Poland and Russia. So this is the very dark turn that technology takes in the mid-20th century. And I think after seeing that, you can't unthink that. You can't deny the political aspects of technology anymore. And it is really an obligation of us as using technology in a creative and critical way to see these things and make them visible and come up with solutions that are not technological, but political,
to make technology
less evil. Not so much changed, you might say, since Hollerith's machines being organized for genocide. I mean, just Google the ethnic cleansing that goes on in China, and you find
all these articles
that point out the role of image recognition technology, but also of other racial screening technologies, like, for example, looking for genetic traits in people's blood, also to identify them as being part of an ethnic minority that against which a genocidal war is fought. Come to the very recent times. I mean, Facebook is working on these issues. I mean, the algorithm that would actively promote the Holocaust denial has been corrected after The Guardian had this story. But it shows you that these machines, that these pieces of technologies really have to be constantly surveyed. We have to be constantly vigilant and discuss and negotiate the political aspects of it. Finally, Facebook seems to take responsibility by, for example, banning the US president after his failed coup to take power illegally. You might say that came a bit late because, I mean, people have asked Facebook to do things like that like 10 years ago already, and they were reluctant until they knew that the majority in the US parliaments had changed, so they would actually not risk anything by now acting. So this is the last chapter, the very recent chapter of political technology, and of course is very interesting now to see where we go from there.
A lot of people.
Technology is not visible. A lot is hidden under surfaces, under shiny surfaces, like, for example, literally, I mean, hidden, locked away in these boxes. And we only see it in the moment when it fails, when the glitches come, when we see the operating system of a digital signage board, we laugh, of course. The technology becoming visible is only when it fails. And I find this piece of art particularly endearing. It is a piece by Richard Kindersley from 1992, from the collection of the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. So Kindersley is a stonemason and sculpturer, and his father was a typographer. So he sees both these worlds, typography and stonemasonry or craftsmanship. And what he does here is he creates these slates of writing in typographic way with the gilded O's using a machine. So they are machine carved. At that time, that was totally cutting edge technology, these laser cutting machines who would clearly do a job that seems superior to the typographic capabilities of the human stonemason. So only when technology is invisible, it is of use to us.
So for the
remaining minutes of this lecture, I want to invite you to have a look together with me on the tools of this class. So you find every information of this lecture series on my GitHub. The link, of course, is provided also in classes. So this is the address of the GitHub. And if we scroll down, you see here all the administrative information, like, for example,
grading
and the rubrics and all these things. But I think more important here is the schedule week by week. So we are in the lecture of the politics of artifacts. Here I have the literature. I describe what we will do in the studio classes. And if you click every week on this button, you come to a Google Sheet that lays out the whole syllabus with the dates, the times when the live classes meet, links to GitHub, where you also find the links to these videos, and then most important, of course, the assignments. Next video, we will look in our studio class into online publishing and look a bit into tools to program instead of being programmed, I mean, to take